Hello everybody and welcome back to the channel. My name is Gavin. This is my channel. I'm glad that you're here. Thank you for joining me. Today we actually have a guest that I am excited to bring on, Suffolk County, New York attorney John Ray, and we're just going to hop into it. John, welcome. Thanks for being here. Well, let's see. I've got you muted again. That was technologically my fault. Sorry about that, John. Welcome.
All right. Thank you.
Glad you're here. So you and I met, just for people who have been long viewers of my channel, they know your name, they know your face, because you and I met as you did work on behalf of Leslie Brill Miserol on a section, what was an Article 78 lawsuit in the state of New York, seeking for mandamus for Amanda Winkowski. That's how we met. So we've known each other for, gosh, probably a year and a half now. Sure. But with all of the changes that have happened, or I guess the changes that have happened in the Long Island serial killer case, with the arrest of Rex Huerman, I thought I'd reach out, and thanks for joining me today on that. So can you tell me how you are connected to the Long Island serial killer case, the Gilgo Beach murders? In general,
I was hired, and that's a word of art because I wasn't paid anything. I was retained by Mary Gilbert, Shannon Gilbert's mother, Shannon being, I guess, the key victim in the case. Right. And her mama, Mary, and I met with a reporter from the New York Daily News back in 2011, right after Shannon's remains had been found in the marsh in Oak Beach, Long Island. And I agreed to help her and represent her in holding a press conference at Oak Beach to call for the police to step out of the case and for the U.S. attorney and the FBI to step in. That was my sole original role.
Why was that important for the case?
At that time, the police commissioner and some of the police had already appeared to have bungled badly the job of the search for Shannon Gilbert. For example, just several days before Shannon's remains were located, the commissioner announced that Shannon had drowned somewhere, and they didn't even know where, and they had no idea whether or not truly she had drowned. They were surmising it, and they announced it as a fact. And that was right after they had located Shannon's jeans, her pocketbook, her cell phone, and other items spread out in the marsh behind a few houses, including the house of someone named Dr. Peter Hackett. When they found those items, they said, aha, she drowned. Those items did not make any indication that she drowned. It was absurd.
The whole, like, thinking that, I don't know, she went swimming, she dropped her stuff and went into the water or something?
There was no. The marsh is a marsh. And, it's covered with loam and reeds and bramble bushes here and there. Standard marsh with mosquito canals, small canals, not very deep. That was it. And they made this announcement, and Mary was completely shocked because there was no evidence to believe that Shannon would have drowned. Shannon was a good swimmer anyway. There was no place to swim or drown, essentially, back in the marsh.
So that
was one of several problems that Mary had encountered and said, this is just, these people are off the charts. They're not competent. And
do you know why? I mean, I'm a person who, I love economics. I love Freakonomics. That's one of my favorite books of all time. I'm always looking for the incentive. Like what is the incentive for people to do the things they do or say the things they say? I guess, what was the incentive for the police commissioner to do that in Shannon Gilbert's case? Any thoughts on that?
It's impossible to really know why such an irrational statement was made without knowing perhaps secrets amongst the police. We have no idea why that claim was made. But only days later, Shannon's remains were found about a quarter of a mile to a third of a mile away in the marsh. She was laying face up with her head on a bush. Her remains were skeletal, and mostly anyway. And th therefore, the theory that she drowned was even more absurd. The police significantly never took a diatom test, which is a test that you take on bones or skin to determine whether a person drowned. They never did that. The
So,
police shifted their claim from drowning to dying of natural causes and unspecified ones to boot. So M Mary was frustrated and disgusted. In addition, she already knew, I had not yet been in the case, that there was a great suspicion that Dr. Peter Hackett was responsible for Shannon's disappearance and death. And for a variety of very public and good reasons, that was not only believed by Mary, but by the public. Even so, when her remains were located, the police took her from Ellenville, New York, upstate, and brought her down to Long Island to show where her daughter was found, and brought her up on a rooftop of a house so she could look from the rooftop deck of the house down into the marsh. And that was Peter Hackett's house. And so she was deeply offended that they did that. And that's why she came to me.
When we talk about the marsh, I mean, how far away from the location? Well, I've got two questions. I should start here. What was the time delta between when she went missing and when her remains were found?
Approximately 1.5 years.
And is your belief that, I mean, she died when she went missing? She wasn't alive for some amount of time between that time?
I do not know that time frame. So far, nobody knows for sure whether she disappeared and was held somewhere and tortured or captured and then died, or whether she died that day. We don't know.
You said that her remains were mostly skeletal, so I would imagine that the autopsy probably was more, what do we call that? And the study of bones is like it's a different study of, why am I blanking on that name? I know of a forensic scientist, a professor up at Mercyhurst University who does this, but basically the examination of her would be mostly of her skeletal remains, not very much soft tissue, I'm guessing, right?
You're largely correct. There was a mat of hair found, and there was skin that had already been completely ossified, mummified, as you wish, on part of her skull. And that was it. And the rest was skeletal remains.
So
So.
I guess how do you make the leap to dying of natural causes if you've just got mostly skeletal remains?
We have no way of knowing to this day why the police insisted and continue to insist upon her death by natural causes. The latest position of the police shifted again, ever so slightly, but subtly and purposely. And that was that on May 13th of 2002, a little over a year ago, a year and a half ago, the police held a press conference in Suffolk County to announce that, after they showed some slides, that Shannon Gilbert died of an unfortunate accident, and a tragic accident, they called it. To this day, they have never submitted to anyone a scintilla of evidence, nor have they cited any to support any of those theories that she drowned, died of natural causes, or of some kind of an accident. And that may not be so important. I mean, maybe it's a guess or an uneducated guess, but you can't do that in this business when you're a homicide department. The homicide police department, in the fifth largest suburban police force in America, are supposed to be highly trained in their work, and their work is dealing with evidence. They suffuse themselves, they immerse themselves in evidence. That's so that when they catch the killer in a case, they can convict that killer beyond a reasonable doubt.
Right.
Therefore, they are extraordinarily devoted to evidence to prove their case. So their lives are completely ensconced in that. And yet, in the case of Shannon Gilbert, they announced these three different causes of death and have no evidence to support any one of those causes whatsoever. That is an absurdity. And it goes against the entire grain of the purpose of the police department. Why would they do that? Why would they announce such an absurd conclusion when there's no evidence to support it?
And well, that's a pattern that I see, though. That's a pattern that I see. Like, if we take a look, it's a pattern I see when there is some, like you said, bungling of the investigation. My first two things that I think of first is the Amanda Winkowski case, right? That is something that the Philadelphia Police Department and Medical Examiner's Office kind of battled in the media. They talked to the residents of Buffalo all the time through the media, and they just wouldn't do that on any other case. And then in Pennsylvania here, my pet case, I love this case, the Ellen Greenberg case, the police bungled the original investigation, and then they talked in the media about, you know, everything, basically trying to prove to the citizens through the media that they did not mess up. But they seem to only do that when they mess up.
Yeah, I can't explain Pennsylvania's, but I, as you know, I worked on the Amanda Winkowski case in Buffalo. I did the Article 78 to compel the medical examiner to change the result of the medical conclusion that she died accidentally. I failed in that because I was blocked by the judge's ruling that there was a statute of limitations to bring the case. And I appealed it. And I argued the appeal, and the court came to the same conclusion. So in Amanda's case, we were blocked. But in Amanda's case, very similar to Shannon's case, the police seem to have used public relations to their advantage to protect and cover their own failures in the investigation. And so that may be a common thing, I'm not sure. But, you know, we in the public, including myself, we tend to think of the police as having sort of a, you know, quasi-sacred role that they play in society, that they really know what they're doing. They're in favor of right, so they know exactly what they're doing. They're great. They're greater human beings. They're like the Vestal Virgins of the temple. And they're not though. You know, they're just people. And how hard do they work on a case? I guess that varies from place to place and time to time.
No, that does make sense, and I think we rightly expect more of our law enforcement because they are doing something that to us is righteous, right? We always want to seek justice when there hasn't been justice, and we put it in the hands of these men and women to seek that justice. But you're right, they're just people, and so they're going to be, they're going to make the same human mistakes that we all make. And I think that if we're all honest with ourselves, if I am a police officer and I colossally screw up, well, the incentives align for me to cover that up, right? It doesn't do anything for me really to fess up to those things. And so,
With the higher vision that they exude, that they espouse of themselves, comes a higher obligation. And that obligation has been violated in Shannon Gilbert's case, like it was in Amanda Winkowski's, but much more so in Shannon's case. Because in Shannon's case, when you consider what I've just explained, that the police have no evidence and yet draw a conclusion to basically close down the case and abandon the work to discover evidence, when that happens, it is not unreasonable to draw the conclusion that they did something very wrong, or that there is something very wrong that they're trying to hide and protect.
Yeah. The Oh, go ahead.
I don't know how else it can be explained.
Yeah. I'm wondering if in the Shannon Gilbert case, it's similar to Amanda's case. I know in the state of New York that investigative files for a crime, you know, are not open to the public. It's not a public document until either the case is solved, the case is closed, or they declare that this is not a crime, right? So have you been able to get your hands on the investigative files in Shannon Gilbert's case?
I have not gotten those files. I've requested them more than once. And always the police answer to my request has been, it's an open, active, ongoing investigation. Now that's, you know, 13 years is a long time for that phraseology to apply.
Especially when they've announced to the public, this was an accident. She drowned, right?
Correct. So where they have officially taken a position that that how she died was not homicide, then their files ought to have been opened.
Yeah.
And they weren't. And they weren't again and again. In fact, when Shannon Gilbert had made a call to 911, it was 23 minutes long, and it's very relevant to how she disappeared and died. We weren't able to get those tapes from the police. We fought through the courts, and I actually brought two different causes of action, and that one on one of them, and that got appealed and got appealed again. And I won at every stage, and eventually they had to give me the tapes of Shannon, but they fought me. And during the fight, they were saying to the public, Shannon died by accident. It was explicitly said by them. And in the same breath in the court, they were saying that it was an open, active criminal investigation when it wasn't. They were lying to the court, basically. So how do you explain that?
Wow. Now, how does Shannon Gilbert's case connect to the other cases in the Long Island serial killer, whole case? We know we have three victims. Let's see, three victims that are connected to Rex Huerman. Looks like it's Melissa Barthelemy, Megan Waterman, and Amber Lynn Costello, if I'm correct. And then a fourth one that they believe is connected to Rex is Maureen Barnes. So how does Shannon connect to the rest of the cases?
Well, when Shannon went missing in May of 2010, her family looked for her immediately and pressured the police departments to do so as well. And they kept the pressure on until I came into the case right after Shannon's remains were found. And we then together kept the pressure on ever since. But during that whole period of time that I've just described, police looking for Shannon discovered the other 10 bodies in Gilgo Beach, Oak Beach stretch of parkway that goes along basically the Jones Beach shore, the south shore of Long Island. And so all the others were discovered because of Shannon. Shannon was the last one to have been found. So they connect in that regard. But just like the others who we know of their occupations, they were sex workers, just as Shannon was. And I retained probably the most world-renowned medical examiner, Michael Budden, to perform our own autopsy on Shannon's bones, which we, after a fashion and some lawsuits, we were able to do. And we discovered that, and he pointed out, he's the expert, that Shannon's bone in her throat, called the hyoid bone, was fractured, was broken, and had a hole drilled or pushed through the middle of the bone U-shaped bone through the base of the bone. And therefore, the conclusion...
Hole drilled through it?
It looked like it was either drilled or punctured or pushed through. But it was a circular hole. And Michael came to the conclusion that her death was consistent with homicide and not consistent with natural causes.
Yeah, a broken hyoid bone is a telltale sign of manual strangulation, of throttling. Wow.
Right. So we had all that evidence, of her having been killed and in a similar fashion. I mean, some of the other girls were also strangled. So when you put all those together and you see, you can picture that the Ocean Parkway area is really an extended graveyard for sex workers and the child of one of them. You recognize that the similarities are pretty hard to miss, and the connection is overwhelmingly obvious to me. So, but more than that, right now, there are no forensic connections per se.
So what is your personal belief? Do you think that Rex Heuermann is likely responsible for Shannon's death?
I can't say he's likely responsible for it. What I can say is that his behaviors, of which we know, make the possibility that he's involved in her death or responsible for her death possible. And that's a reasonable possibility. No guarantees, but I put him in the area of suspect. We also think that there are more people involved in the death of Shannon Gilbert than one person.
What makes you think that?
Well, a number of things make me think that. For example, the 23-minute tape, if you listen to it carefully and you can put enhancements upon the voices, you can hear other people, voices, men's voices in the background. While she's calling 911. There's also she makes statements on the tapes. The public has tapes now, so they can hear it themselves. And you hear her say, when she opens up with, "Someone is after me. Someone is after me." Someone is a person. It's one person. She didn't say they were after me. Mm-hmm. And Brewer was standing right next to her or right in her vicinity when she makes that statement. So she could not possibly have been referring to him. It makes no sense. And so she was referring to someone, but soon after that, she then starts talking about, "They are trying to kill me. They are trying to kill me." And they is plural.
Yeah. That, man, the imagination just conjures all these different scenarios that could have been going on there, right? But I've wondered about that whole Oak Beach, Gilgo Beach area being that marshy land. Could that just possibly be a place that killers just know that's a good place to drop a body? Or is it, one person or a group of interconnected, closely connected people that have been using that as a graveyard?
It requires you to strain your imagination, and that's not a very good tactic when you're doing forensic work. It requires you to strain your imagination to believe that there are a variety of unrelated killers who just happen to like to kill sex workers and dump them all in approximately the same place on the same side of the road, except for Shannon on the other side of the road, and to dump their, in several cases, to dump body parts because they were beheaded. Their arms were chopped off, legs were chopped off in some cases, and their trunks were found in various other places on Long Island. And all of that would be coincidence? I don't think so.
Yeah. This reminds me, we should tell people that you have a symposium, a presentation that you're going to be making on January 30th from 3:30 to 7:30. This is going to be a big presentation. It's open to the public. There's no charge to do it. It's at St. John's University in Queens, New York, inside Marillac Hall. Now, at this presentation, you're going to be talking about, well, tell us what you're going to be talking about in this presentation.
My purpose for the symposium, which I'm the presenter, is to summarize the evidence that I've gathered for years now in Shannon Gilbert's case, as well as in the other cases dealing with Gilgo Beach, and to also focus on the latest developments dealing with Rex Hurryman and his wife, and also to reveal new evidence that I have come to have. So it has all those elements in it. And the purpose behind it is I guess it's manifold, but one of those things is, one of the purposes is that a lot of discussions by the police over the years and by others in authority have been made about not only the cases, but my involvement in the cases, what I know, what I don't know, what I've said, and so forth. So I want to make basically a presentation, a record of exactly what I do know and what we do have in summary form. We couldn't possibly, with the 13, I'm into my 13th year of investigating on this case, with the 13 years of investigation, if I were to try to present all of the forensic evidence and the logical conclusions therefrom in even 4 hours, it would be impossible. You'd need 12, 15 hours. I've put in well over 50,000 hours of work on this case, or cases, I should say. And I'm still going. So it's time to just put it out there and say to the public once and for all, this is what we know. You decide. You decide whether what I'm saying is reasonable or not.
And is that the format? Are you going to be presenting facts and evidence, or are you going to also be drawing conclusions? How are you going to present that?
I'm going to present evidence and conclusions that I draw from those evidences, but I'm also going to leave open, there's different levels of evidence, so I'm going to leave open conclusions in many, many situations, leave that up to the public by saying, look, here is the evidence, you tell us, you decide, what do you think is true here? Because these are things that have not been put to you by the police or by anybody else, but I'm putting them to you. So now you think about it and you come to your own thoughts. Now there's different levels. I mean, there's the level of the evidence is overwhelming. So one doesn't need to worry about conclusions. They speak for themselves. And there's the next level is where there's a lot of forensic evidence but there are perhaps a main inference, but there are other inferences as well. Then there's that level where there's inferences, a variety of conclusions, but nobody's quite sure what they mean. And then finally, the speculative evidence, which is valuable, which is interesting, but which is not conclusive. And so I'm going to address them all.
Now, are you going to be live streaming this as well?
We are going to be live streaming this. And I believe several of the media, there will be media there. Several of them will be live streaming it as well. So,
all right, I'll get that link information from you, offline, and I'll share that with my viewers when the time is nearing. There were a couple questions that came in, John, when I asked my viewers what I should talk to you about. Let me just grab a couple questions here. The first question is, having now heard Rex Hurryman's voice, do you think that it was Rex who was calling your house and sent the pizza? Maybe we should tell a little bit that story. And then what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, you can tell. Do you know the story?
I watched an interview that you did. So yeah, I understand what happened.
Yeah, it was the pizza incident was the second time that we had this eerie phone call, the full phone call that is at issue here. The first one having been in January, and then in
that
March.
That one had to do with your daughter, right? That was like a threat.
It was indeed a direct threat. It had to do with our daughter, and it was very perceptive, very accurate. And, I should say efficiently done. And so it rattled us enough that the FBI went to our daughter's you know, she was at an Olympic training camp. She's a big race walker, and you know, she has national records and such. So it's her first time away from home without us, and it was pretty shocking that we had to have the FBI go and make sure she was okay. And then the second time was March 16th, and I had worked my usual long hours, and I was home at 9 o'clock. We were having dinner at the countertop, you know, in the kitchen, and we have a lot of windows. We're surrounded by forest, small forest and hills, and so it's dark, and you could see into our house. So we were sitting, the three of us, and the phone call came, and it was exactly the same phone call type that we had in January. Starts off with a hashing sound, and then with broken, silly, crazy music. And then a voice comes on of a reporter reporting on the Gilgo Beach situation from back in 2011, 2012. So somebody tape recorded that. And then came on a male voice, an adult voice, and said something to the effect that, I hope you're enjoying your dinner. And we were having dinner, the three of us. So, you know, we having experienced this before, my family dropped to the floor. And seconds later, you know, seconds later, maybe it was a half a minute, something like that. I can't remember exactly. The phone rang again. And this time it was the same noises and such, except this time, a voice came on. It was a woman's voice, and an adult woman's voice. And she said, I hope you like you're enjoying your pizza. And within seconds of that, the front doorbell rang. Now we're up on a hill, 86 feet up on a 45 degree angle. So nobody walks up that hill in the darkness and rings your bell that time. And so my family started crying and they were scared stiff. I went to the window that I could see outside, and there stood a man holding three boxes of pizza from Domino's, rather. And so luckily we were able to catch some of the voice. We got the tape of the woman's voice, so we still have it. And we called the police. Police came. They thought it was a prank. They didn't know enough.
Not about a funny prank.
They didn't know enough about the case to know why it wasn't a prank. And so we called the pizza place. The police is standing there. And the man who answered took the phone call that had called in the pizza order that came to our house. And it was a woman who called with a man in the background sounding casually like they were ordering. They made it a Hawaiian pizza with the pineapples. That's happened to be a pizza we particularly like. So it was, I mean, how much did these people spend time on? I mean, it was bizarre.
Yeah.
So the guy mentions this and he says that's the call he got. And the reason that they delivered they didn't get paid yet was because they had my phone on file, then they got the phone number from these people and they gave them my phone number. So it was, whoever was doing it was really not playing a prank. It was far more in the neighborhood of a taunting sort of stalking that was going on. We then ordered our telephone records to see the calls, and sure enough, all the calls, and there were two or three others as well that were made that weren't quite as extensive as the one in January or March. And in every one of those calls, the calls originated in my hometown, which is a small town. So whoever was making those calls was there at my house, very likely. So, you know, was it Horiman? We know that he was a stalker. He was into that very kind of behavior. I don't know if it was him and somebody else. I don't know.
Wow. That is a terrifying story. That's, yeah. That is the reason, Our house is chock full of windows too. I counted one time. I think our house has 57 windows, not including the stained glass, just like 57 windows that you can look into our house with. And man, every single one of them are covered as soon as night falls. So I'm terrified of that stuff.
Well, you know, we've changed our behavior too. And, and security, and we have to get security. So.
Wow. Here, the second question is, do you believe that Huerman is connected to the Route 29 stalker cases in Virginia, or are there any other cases that you think that he might be connected to?
Well, another good question. I have evidence that I'm going to present at the symposium on that very point. And I do think that Huerman is connected to things in Virginia.
All right. So definitely tune in to the symposium. That's a good tease. Question number three, I think we kind of went through this. What was the link between Huerman and Shannon Gilbert? And I think just the what you have said, the fact that they're all sex workers, they're all found in the same location, that's probably the main link.
There is an indirect link regarding this. When a woman came forward to me and gave us an affidavit, which I've given to the police and which the public is aware of, this taxi driver who was not a sex worker or you know, involved in any of the illicit sexual activities that Huerman was involved in, she came forward and she was able to say that she had picked up a fare at the Sayville Motor Lodge, which is over on Sunrise Highway, which on Long Island is not very far. It's south Long Island, so it's not very far from the Parkway and how you get to Oak Beach. Anyway, she picked up a fare in that motel that turned out to be Shannon Gilbert, and this huge man who came out from the room where Shannon was. And she recognized him later on. He came again and called her a second time and threatened her with a gun. And she is clearly able to identify him as Rex Huerman. So
you have a witness that has Shannon Gilbert and Rex Huerman together.
Correct. That's correct.
So I'm thinking that there are going to be some pretty big revelations at this symposium that you're doing on the 30th of January.
It looks like that's true.
I hope that it's successful, that a lot of people tune in, a lot of people show up. This is an important case. I am curious. I know that Mary Gilbert has passed away, who I'm assuming is your client in all of this. So what, I guess my question is, what's keeping you going on Shannon's case?
You know, it's a hard question to answer. I've been asked it several times, and each time I answer it, I'm not sure of my own answer. It's so difficult to really focus in on this. But first, I mean, in no particular order, I finish what I start. And you might say that's, you know, a creed. But I also became devoted to helping out this sad family, the Gilbert family, and the sadness that pervaded them from all of this. I came to have great regard for not only Shannon, but the other sex workers. And I learned a great deal about sex work in the case and came to realize that they were, those little girls were, they were just girls, little girls who never had the chance to grow up. Their childhood was skipped over by other people who forced them to do things and put them in bad situations so that, unlike most of us, they didn't have a childhood of any goodness. And they were in the spots where they were, not from their own fault. And they certainly didn't deserve the appalling result of their slaughter, their murder. And so you know, I became devoted to seeing my way to getting them what I think is really what's at stake here. And that is by getting them the truth and having the truth known, which they may not even know, even now. They're still, you know, they still live. Their souls are alive. Souls live forever. And so they are entitled to the truth. And if they get the truth, I think it's possible for them to also have mercy. And they do need the mercy of God after the poor things were slaughtered as they were. So that's in my DNA, shall we say. That's how I look at it. And in addition to that, I have a visceral distaste for the abuse of authority by any authority, including law enforcement, while at the same time I hold the police in high regard and consider them, you know, as decent people and sometimes extraordinarily brave people. Still, in this case, in these cases, there's a bungling that took place because of police corruption that isn't the fault of everyday police officers, but the fault of the administration of the police in this very wealthy police district called Suffolk County Police Department. And I can't let that go. So is that an answer?
That's a good answer. And I know we've only got a few minutes left. I want to be respectful of your time, but there, you know, talking about the truth, I think the thing that draws me to these cases, especially the ones where there is some secondary offense, like, you know, we've talked about Amanda, for example. So Amanda was in a very similar situation as the victims of the Gilgo Beach, Long Island serial killer victims, where she had found herself doing sex work. She had found herself addicted to drugs. But I always think about the value of a life, right? What is the value of a life? And, you know, in Amanda's case, for example, she was doing all those things at the same time and sometimes with her sister who was doing those things. And here we are 13, 14 years later, and her sister has been able to kick those habits and has children and has a family and is contributing to society. And her value is no greater than Amanda's value when Amanda died. But one of the things that I struggle with is that if it's true that all life has value, then so does the life of those who perpetrate the crimes.
Completely correct.
Right? So, I mean,
I formed this not-for-profit corporation to assist in helping out the poor people who are in situations like this. And I'm, you know, I run it. I'm the Magdalene Dismas Society, and it's named after Saint Mary Magdalene, who was by reputation a prostitute, and yet she became the closest friend of Jesus. So much so that she was allowed to be the first one at his gravesite on Easter Sunday. And Dismas was the good thief hanging on the cross to the right of Jesus, and Jesus promised him to be the first one in heaven. So a thief and a prostitute, and look at how they were treated. So if we can't follow that a great man like Christ could have honored them both in their situations, their occupations, where are we? Yeah, these little girls and as bad as it may seem, Horiman himself and others, they're all, you know, came from the same source. We're all at one time children. And that's how I see people. At one time they were children. Mm-hmm. Something went wrong. And maybe we can do something about that.
That's a great place to end too. Thanks, John. Appreciate you joining me today for these few minutes. I really hope that people join you on January 30th from 3:30 to 7:30 at St. John's University in Queens at Mar a Lac Hall. I certainly will be sharing the link to the live stream for those who can't make it in person. And I think that is where we'll leave it. If you'll just hang out for me just a second, let me finish out And then let me just talk to you offline real quick. All right. Thanks everybody for joining me today. I appreciate it so much. We will see you on the next one. All right. Take care. Thank you very much for watching this video. If you liked what you saw, please consider subscribing. And if you have any questions or comments, please leave them below.